With in excess of 1,000 wheel horsepower and a best ever trap speed in a half mile race event of 199 mile an hour, Aaron's EG Civic is obviously no slouch. However, there's a few things that make it a little unusual compared to your typical Civic. Now, the obvious one there, when we look in the engine bay, Aaron, there's no B series engine in there. Can you tell us about the J series engine swap you've done?
This particular car has a J Series V6, which started Honda in 1997. This one is a 03 block, I believe. It's a 3.5 liter. And then I used the cylinder heads from the, in the US, the Acura TL, that had the bigger valves and bigger ports.
Now, it's pretty well shown that the B Series engine is easily capable of supporting 1,000 wheel horsepower, well in excess. We also know that there's no replacement for displacement. So what exactly was the driving force behind going to the J Series swap?
After seeing how well our GTRs did at making power and staying together, I thought about it and know that a 1,000 horsepower four cylinder really has passes in it. It doesn't have miles. So my feeling was that if I did a V6, made the same power, spread it out over more cylinders, that hopefully I would have more reliability.
I think that's an aspect that is so easy to overlook with all of the information we see on the internet, with forums, videos, etc. It looks from the outside like it's incredibly easy to make 11, 12, 13, even 1500 horsepower from a small capacity four-cylinder engine, and that gives us the idea that it's also going to be reliable. But as you say, it just simply isn't the case, and I think it's lost on a lot of people. Once you're north of 1000 wheel horsepower, there are going to be some reliability problems there. Another issue with the EG chassis, particularly when you're making big power, of course, is the drivetrain. Mm-hmm. What have you done there to make the drivetrain hold together?
This car uses the transmission from a TL 6-speed as well. So it has a factory limited slip transmission, akin to like an Integra Type R. I have stock first, second, and third gears, but I do have straight cut fourth gear from M Factory, stock fifth gear. And then we deleted sixth gear and used a cuff to hold the input and output shafts together.
So in most instances, at these sort of power levels, we'd see people reaching for a full aftermarket transmission or at least a dog engagement gear set, but you've found that this combination is holding together reliably?
As far as power levels, yes. Making 700 plus foot-pounds of torque, I haven't broke anything other than fourth gear, which is why I replaced it. The problem with the J Series is it's not well supported as of yet. There's no dog box option, so it's making do with what I have, basically.
Now, it's all well and good swapping to a larger capacity engine. You've gone to 3.5 litres. Obviously, that brings down the sort of specific power level or power per cylinder when you're at that 1,000-plus wheel horsepower mark. But still, there's not a lot of factory naturally aspirated engines that are going to support that. Well, what have you done inside that engine to make it reliable?
Surprisingly little. I have Wiseco Pistons, Pauter X beam connecting rods, but it's still a stock sleeve, stock crankshaft. I use factory Honda gaskets, head gaskets. Recently, we did add camshafts. Crower has a camshaft option where it's a reground stock one. Again, not too much support, but enough to at least get me something. So we supplied that. I've tried a couple of different intake manifolds and ended up modifying a stock intake manifold for the most reliability as far as that goes.
Now, obviously, in terms of getting the power out of the engine, it's really all about getting boost into the engine. So what's the turbocharger that you fitted?
Last year, I used a Precision 7285. I've been very pleased with how the Precision turbos work. This year, we have the Precision 8385, so I stepped it up quite a lot. I do use a divided T4 turbine housing with a 128 AR.
So is that to take sort of advantage of the fact you've got a V6 engine and you're running one bank into each of the sides of the housing?
Correct. So I actually am able to use a twin scroll effect because of the firing order, which helps response time between shifts. Not having that dog box, any amount of time that I'm wasting shifting, I'm losing boost.
I'll just actually touch on that because that was what was going through my mind with the synchro mesh box. You actually are forced to use the clutch to shift. So when you've got a large turbo on an engine, even with 3.5 litres capacity, it's likely to drop off boost. So you get a lot of lag coming back into that next gear, which was where the dog box with flat shifting is an advantage. Okay, so what boost levels are you running to make that sort of power?
We've ran it up to 41 pounds. We did have some issues at 41 pounds, but it wasn't the engine at that time, it was the inlet manifold. 37 pounds, the fuel flow was approximately 1,140 horsepower, comparing to our other race cars where I have data to go look at.
Now, putting all of that power through just the front wheels could potentially be a bit challenging. So what strategies are you using at a half-mile race event in order to retain traction?
Like most race cars, I start with good tires. So I'm using, in this case, some slicks, Mickey Thompson Pro Bracket Radial Slick. Finding the correct air pressure was very essential. This correct suspension, having the damper set properly. But then moving to the electronic side, I'm employing traction control, boost per gear. We've tried using drive-by-wire as part of the traction control strategy also. I had other issues with that, so we had to go back to the cable. But between limiting the amount of torque per gear, having a fairly well set up chassis, and then the traction control to kind of clean up anything I might have missed, it's really worked pretty well.
So the idea there is you're not really relying on that traction control solely. You're really trying to tune the power delivery of the car to suit the track as you go down the track. And then you're relying that traction controls this there in the background as sort of a safety measure just in case you do break into wheel spin.
Correct. So I always think in terms of torque. First gear, I can only put down maybe 400 foot-pounds of torque with the current setup. Second gear, I can get 500, maybe 510. Third gear, I can get it closer to 600 foot-pounds. By the time I get to fourth or fifth gear, I'm putting down everything that the motor can make, so 700 plus. With nitrous, I'm assuming over 800 foot-pounds.
You just mentioned that nitrous, so touch on that. How are you using the nitrous? Is that spraying the whole way down, or are you using it for anti-lag?
I'm using it to help respool the turbo, yes. What we found on the last setup without the nitrous is that my response time from 7 PSI to 34 PSI was 3/4 of a second almost. Using just 100 horsepower worth of nitrous, I got that down to 0.28 seconds. So substantial increase.
Particularly when you're potentially in excess of 150 mile an hour, that 3/4 of a second that it takes to get back on boost, you're covering a lot of distance. So again, that sort of comes back to the fact you can't run a dog box with flat shift, yes?
Correct. And then it kind of gives me the option of, if I feel that I've ever ran out of turbo, I can just use the nitrous all the way through the gear also.
Now, the electronics which you've touched on there, you've talked about the traction control, nitrous control, drive-by-wire, etc. What is the ECU you're using?
In this particular car, I'm using an AEM Infinity. It's the 7 series, the 708 specifically. I also have the CD7 Dash and the VDM so that I have acceleration data. I have everything in front of me where I can see exactly what the engine's doing, which for the most part is usually just in the pits, but the shift light function and all that while I'm actually on the track.
So when you're on the track, as you've just said, the shift light, really, that's the only thing you're focusing on unless something goes wrong. But could you talk us through some of the sensors that you use, or look at the data from at least, when you get back to the pits, to give you an idea of the health of the engine and then let you know what direction to take in order to improve how the car's performing?
I use a lot of common sensors. I use knock sensors. This particular motor I have outfitted with two Bosch flat response knock sensors. I have exhaust manifold pressure sensors, EMAP or EBP, some people will call it, to see if the turbo is out of housing, where I'm at relative to boost. I'm always watching the lambda. For our particular form of racing, I do have to run a little bit richer to keep the motor happy by and large. So instead of running a gasoline equivalent of like a 12-to-1 air fuel ratio, I'm running an 11.1 to help keep the EGT down.
Just touching on that, you're running on an ethanol based fuel?
Correct. I'm using Ignite 114, which is ethanol based and then refined from there. But it's not something that's just mixed and put at the pump.
And just for those out there who are going to jump on that, you've just quoted 11.1 as an air fuel ratio, and you did say equivalent on the gasoline air fuel ratio scale. I know we get a lot of people confused about the different stoichiometric air fuel ratio, so I'll just put that out there just before we get head up about it. Okay, so in terms of those knock sensors, generally when we're getting to the 1,000 plus wheel horsepower mark in a relatively small engine, generally, if we encounter much in the way of detonation, that's going to end up damaging the engine quite quickly. Are you relying on those knock sensors for knock control, or is it just data that you can look at?
I do use it mostly for just the data. The AEM does allow you to establish a knock floor, where if you feel that that's a safe level because you're not seeing random spikes occur, that's safe for that motor. That takes a lot of experience, some trial by error, usually using a low octane fuel to actually instigate some knock so you can see what that background level is. But like you said, because of what we're doing, the RPM involved, the boost pressures, mostly it's for reference on this particular motor.
All right, look, Aaron, we know that despite what we've just talked about, you actually have already suffered this weekend with some unknown mechanical problem. And of course, this is the world we live in. This is the sport that we love. And when you're pushing boundaries, things do inevitably get damaged. So you've run 189 mile an hour already today. There's not going to be any more runs from you, but it's certainly an impressive car. We look forward to seeing you get it back together, find out whatever was wrong, fix it, come back stronger, and we look forward to seeing you break that 200 mile an hour mark in the not too distant future. Thanks for the time to chat there, Aaron.
Thank you.
That video, make sure you give it a thumbs up, and if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.